The scripture talks about a special group of people living in the last days. By faith, they will take hold of the promises of God's word and will live for Christ. Join Pastor Cox as he talks about the uncompromising life.
I walked into a doctor's office years ago in a place called Rato, New Mexico. And on the wall of the doctor's office was a plaque. And on that plaque was words that made an indelible impression upon my mind, one that I had never forgotten. And the words on that plaque simply said this: men are like rivers. If they follow the course of least resistance, they wind up quickly. Very, very true. We live in an age of compromise, an age in which man is willing to just about compromise anything. In the last few years, we have seen ministers compromise their beliefs, compromise their morals. We live in a time in which politicians will compromise about anything. Doctors being willing to compromise things that they hold for and should not compromise. We live in an age of compromise. We find the church very much in a compromising position today. We find if the world has a fasting movement, so does the church. If the world all of a sudden has rock music, so does the church. If the world has a women's liberation movement, so does the church. In fact, the church has found itself in such a compromising position for so long that I'm not sure the church would recognize an uncompromising life if they saw one. God today is calling upon men and women to be men and women of principle, men and women that are willing to stand for certain things and not compromise and not move, but to stand by faith and say, this is what God asks of me, and I will do this no matter what takes place or what happens. That's what God is looking for and asking for. You see, the Christian is called upon to stand just as Daniel of old stood. For it says here, that Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's delicacies, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore he requested the chief of eunuchs that he might not defile himself. Daniel stood and he said, I won't compromise. I will stand here. And he refused. He said, come what may, I won't move from this. I refuse to compromise. God expects that of us today, just as much as Daniel of old. You see, the Christian is kind of like a boat. A boat was made to be in the water. As long as the boat's in the water, it's fine. But if the water gets inside the boat, it's in trouble. The Christian was made to be in the world. And God didn't make you to be a hermit. He didn't make you to go off and be by yourself. God didn't make you that way. He made it to be here in the world. And he prayed about that in John 15. And the Christian was made to be in the world, and that's fine. But when the world gets on the inside of the Christian, he's in trouble. There's a great, great difference there, friends. And in this area, you and I must not compromise. The moment we compromise, it affects two things in our Christian life, and it affects those two things very, very strongly in the two things that it affects is, one, it has a lot to do with my worship. You can't compromise and have your worship be what it should be. It says this: do not love the world or the things of the world. God said, don't love the world or the things of the world. If any man loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. So you and I, as individuals, cannot be of the world. That's impossible. They're not compatible. I find so many people that want to make them compatible. They're not compatible. You love the Lord or you love the world, but you can't love them both. Impossible. In fact, it goes on in James and says this: adulterers and adulteress, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Whoever therefore wants to be a friend of the world makes himself a enemy of God. So you can't put the two together. You will never be able to. I have to make that decision, and if I don't, then it affects my worship. It has a very, very profound effect upon my worship to God. So when I compromise, it affects my worship. Secondly, it not only affects my worship, but it also has a lot to do with my service. I want you to follow me carefully in what I'm going to say. Because I'm going to give a principle. I'm going to give you a principle now that can make all the difference in the world in your Christian experience. Okay? We're talking about being of service to God. Okay? And if you give your heart to the Lord Jesus Christ, then I can tell you right now, the Scripture says that you are to serve. Like the Lord said, you are to minister to other people. That's what he calls us to do. Right. You are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Now, folks, those statements I just read to you do not say this. God doesn't say, if you act a certain way, I'll make you a priest. It doesn't say, if you act a certain way, you're a chosen generation. That isn't what that's saying. God says, I have made you. I have made you a priest. I have made you a chosen generation. I have made you a special people. Therefore, because you are to act like one. You understand what I'm saying? God doesn't say, act this way and you will become a child of God. That isn't what he says. He said, I will make you a child of God, and since you are a child of God, you ought to act like one. There's a difference there. When you accept that you are a child of God, that you do belong to the Lord, then, dear friends, you and I can merely act like we are. If I compromise that, then that affects my service to the Lord. It affects you very, very definitely. But in the great house, there are not only vessels of gold and silver, but also of wood and clay. Some for honor and some for dishonor. Do you understand that text? Do you understand what Paul is saying? He's saying in the great house, the rich house, there are vessels, some gold, some silver, and some of wood and some of clay, some for honor and some for dishonor. Now, I don't know at your house, but in my home, where I grew up, my mother, although they weren't silver and gold, but my mother had some vessels of honor and some of dishonor. You understand what I'm talking about? Oh, my mother had a tiny cabinet over there that she kept vessels of honor. And then she had a bunch of vessels of dishonor. and we ate out of the vessels of dishonor. And when we had special company, we ate out of the dishes of honor. You understand? Okay, that's what he's talking about here. The great man's house, there's two different types of vessels. Now listen, he's talking about you and me. We're talking about service. Therefore, if anyone cleanses himself from the latter, he will be a vessel for honor, sanctified and useful for the master, prepared for every good work. So you see, as an individual, must maintain that relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ so I can be a vessel of honor. That's what he wants me to do. If I compromise that, I lose it. And so you and I cannot enter into that, dear friends. And God is looking for men and women today that are not willing to compromise. So tonight, I want us to look at the case of Daniel. Because if there's ever a case in Scripture of an uncompromising life, Daniel was it. There's never been anybody that lived a more uncompromising life than Daniel did. If you pick up your Bible, in most cases, and you read about David, and you read about Abraham, and you read about the things that says that they were great, it said about them after they died. You know? He talks about these different people that after they died, it says they were great. Except in the case of Daniel. Now, folks, look at this section of Ezekiel. Though these three men, Noah, Daniel, and Job, now Noah and Job were dead, okay? Not Daniel. Noah, Daniel, and Job were in it. They would deliver themselves by their righteousness, says the Lord. Now he's saying here that if Noah, Job, and Daniel were in the land, the only ones they would be able to deliver themselves from is themselves. In other words, Noah or Daniel or Job can't share their righteousness with you. They can't do that. But the point I'm making is Ezekiel is a contemporary of Daniel. He lives at the same time Daniel lived. And here he's pointing out two men that are dead, Noah and Job, but not Daniel. He was alive, classified as righteous. I can tell you right now, Daniel didn't compromise. I don't care if he was making the king mad or if he's going to be fed the lions. He didn't compromise. Let's look at his life. Nebuchadnezzar. Nebuchadnezzar was taken captive, about 70 young men. And he told his guard to select certain young men, and he told their qualifications. Young men in whom there is no blemish, but good looking, gifted in all wisdom, possessing knowledge, and quick to understand, who had ability to serve the king's palace, and whom they might teach the language and literature of the Chaldeans. He said, go out and select me some good young men that are smart, good looking, and the ability to serve the king. Find me some young men like this, and they got 70 of them. The king didn't care. He didn't say, find me some young men that are smart. Find me some young men that are good looking. Find me some young men that have social graces. Find me some young men that are moral. Find me some young men that are spiritual. He didn't ask for that. He said, find me some young men that are smart, good looking, and have social graces. And he stopped right there. When they got to 70 of them, they got some of them that were moral and they got some of them that were spiritual. And he didn't know what to do with them. Right, the selecting of young men like this. So, they select them, and this is what it says, who they were. Now, from among those of the sons of Judah were Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, four young men. These young men, smart. They're thinking. They got great social graces.
of the Lord.
To them, the chief of the eunuchs gave names. He gave Daniel the name of Belshazzar, and Hananiah, Shadrach, and Mishael, Meshach, and Azariah, and Abednego. Changed their names. Now, folks, you must understand. Nebuchadnezzar said, go out here and select this young man, and I want to bring him back to Babylon, and I want to train him. I want to train this young man to work in my court there, and if I'm going to train him to work in my court and be of service to me, I've got to bring him for him. So the first thing I've got to do is I've got to get rid of their names, because their Hebrew names stood for something. So I said, I'm going to get rid of their names first. So Daniel, you know what the word Daniel in Hebrew means? It means God is judge. God is judge. Changes it to Belshazzar, which means Baal, that is their God, provides. The God Baal will provide. So let's change that. We don't want you to say God is judge. We can come to the name of Hananiah. Beautiful name in Hebrew. It means the Lord is gracious. And change it. Shadrach, exalt a two, the God of two. But we don't want to say God is gracious. We want to forget their God. Still, he is what the Lord is. Change it to Meshach, he is what a two is. We don't want to talk about the Lord. Azariah, the Lord is my helper. Change it to Abednego, servant of Nebuchadnezzar. Change all your names. Make a different name. So we got to take these young men and we got to change the names, get in Babylonian names. We don't want them to serve the gods of the Hebrews. We want them to serve the Babylonian gods. They want them to serve the God of heaven. But we want them to serve the Babylonian. So not only are we going to give them different names, we've got to give them an education. Young men who there is no blemish. The good looking gifted in all wisdom, discussing knowledge, and quick to understand, who had ability to serve in the king's palace, and he may not teach the language and the literature of the Chaldeans. They said, let's give these young men an education. I can spend the rest of the night right here. I just want to say to you, you better be careful with your children. You better stop and take a good, hard look at where you have that child education. Put that child out there so they're being taught. Constantly taught them that it's nothing but fables. And then you think your child's going to come out okay? You better be careful. If you're going to send them somewhere like that, you better spend some time with that child that you need to teach them something else. We're going to get an education. We're going to show them that this is what they believe. It's not true. So they begin to give them more attention. Not only did that, they do that, but it's just this. And the king appointed to them the daily portion of the king's delicacies, and the wine which he drank, and 3 years of training for them, so that at the end of that time they may serve before the king. Not only were they going to change their names, they were going to give them more education, but they can tell you something about brainwashing. Brainwashing always uses the idea of obligating the person to you. So the king said, no, bring them right into you, and have them sit down at my table, and we'll feed them with the food at my table. Boy, that's pretty nice. So the king stopped. too. Years ago, I was in the state of Texas working there. And I had some friends in Texas that the Lord has blessed me special way. I'm not sure. And they called me up one day and said, go to the ball game with me. I said, yeah, I'd like to go to the ball game. They said, good, we'll come by and pick you up. I said, fine, they told me the time. And I got ready to go to the ball game, and the Lord then gave me this black Cadillac driving up to my house. They got out and said, you got this black Cadillac, and we drove off to the ball game. I said, they're those black Cadillacs. I said, this is all right. We might have been there this year, but that's because of the challenges that we have to go back to here. A few thoughts about it. The idea of this is I stop and wait and wait for the traffic to and then I have to buy a ticket to park. And usually I have to park way back there and walk and have to buy a ticket to park. I don't know if you have that to drive, but that's what it is to me. Well, they didn't drive up there to the rest of the campus. Then they go over here, and that's the place for them. They got there to come with this wave of mine on the train. Didn't stop long. And they didn't park way out there. They drove right up to the station, and here they had a special place reserved for them. I thought, man, what is that? Really enjoyed it. Got out of the car. I used to go over there and buy a ticket to go to the gate and you walk up this lane to go up there. And then it took me to buy a half a mile away from the bar. There were little midgets on them. So I set out to get up where the door up normal. They said, no, no, no. So, yeah, here we go there. And here they take me over there. And here's the elevator. I didn't even know what the elevator was. I didn't know what it was. Just the button. Elevator, we got on the elevator, we went here, and here this elevator door is open. And I think we're one of our team. I'm here with beautiful, all white, positive mind, and here, fellow students, one of the doctors. We stepped out, and they said, follow us, took us down here, and here they opened this door, and we walked in there, and I think we're one of our team. And here was plate glass windows looking over. The ball field, you know. And plus, it's not just the field of the ball field. You know, like three televisions getting in and just watch at the same time. There's an unexpected ball game. And one of these fellows at Rubber Stand, he said, Mr. Fox, is there anything you'd like? I said, what do you mean? He said, would you like something to drink or to eat? Anything you'd like? I thought, man, this is okay. This is living it up, you know. I said, you're a distinctive. I'm just trying to tell you, that was the King's table. He's the King's table. Having someone there waiting on you all the time, boy, that could be enticing. Very much so. Put you in a situation where you can compromise. Give that what you believe. If you don't think you're going to do it, where you're in a position to compromise, you're going to do it. Why? You're going to be able to compromise the position of race. The position of losing the fact. I want you to just look at the facts and say to those who are watching. Go away! These young men, the 70 young men that they have taken from Israel to Babylon, are somewhere between 15 and 17 years old. They're not men that have been tried. They're not men that have had experience. They're not individuals. They've gone through this before. They're young and tried. So, you're talking about compromise? You better believe there is a reason to compromise. They're young. Secondly, they're away from home. They're a long way from home, over 1,000 miles. You know, Jesus actually is miles from home. But people are away from home. They're just Thank you. Thank you. for us, that is for the good. But just to have the only difference is for the good. I'm going to go to the next one. if you look at that word, bitterness can be bitterness. If you look at that word, you can see that it tells you what that word bitterness is. scripture says, don't do it. Right. I won't do it because maybe I do it to heaven. No. 1,000 times no. I'm telling you, because you are a child of God, act like one. Don't do it. Therefore, I will not compromise what the scripture says. I will do it. I won't. You trying to tell me that if I don't eat in 3 weeks, that I won't get to heaven? That's not good for you. Time for you. God says your body is God's temple. Don't eat it. I'm telling you, word of God. Secondly, folks, I can't compromise on my lifestyle. I refuse to compromise on my lifestyle. Daniel refused. He said, I won't do that. He said, oh, did you eat that bread? He said, oh, yes, I did. But now I'm going to compromise on my lifestyle. Establish the Lord.
Thank you. Thank you.